Shabbat Shalom. What a beautiful day, isn't it? It's gorgeous. Well, this is quite a week from many different aspects. Service and survival. That's the title of my sermon today. Sometimes I don't say what the title of my sermon is, but service and survival. You know, this week, of course, the world was enthralled and still is thinking about the Chilean miners, the Los 33. I can't say it in Spanish. Los 33 in French. That doesn't work, but they're thinking about very much about what contributed to their survival and their incredible story. You know, there's this nice editorial, the main lead editorial in the Times Colonist, talking about this. A world shares miners' victory. A world shares miners' victory. Because it is quite a story. Over 1 billion people watched the rescue of these miners. It's one of the best good news stories that has been around for some time. It really is a remarkable story. And what contributed to their survival? You know, when that collapse happened, they were 700 meters down. 700 meters below the surface of the earth. That's a fairly good distance. You're definitely not clawing your way out of that, especially when your exit is blocked by over 700,000 metric tons of fallen rock. You're not getting out of there for some time. The miners, of course, the 33 miners, were, when the collapse happened, were acutely aware of their danger. They had all sorts of external pressures on them that was going to make their life extremely difficult. They had the heat. You know, there was a constant heat of 30 degrees. Because you're getting closer to the core of the earth, 30 degrees centigrade at all times. And you know how it is when it's hot and it stays hot and it stays hot. And they had very limited water, which is what they had on hand. They had limited food, a few cans of this, some bars of that, a little of this, a little of that, whatever they had for their lunches. And they had, of course, as they were acutely aware of, a depleting amount of oxygen as well to add to their problems and difficulties. But besides these external pressures, they had internal pressures. They had the despair they had to live with, wondering for 17 days if anyone still thought they were alive. Or were they buried forever? 700 meters below the surface of the earth. In the course of those 17 days, these men, with their, of course, you know, it's total blackness except for their lights on their whatever they could get in their battery power that they might be able to scrounge, either that they had on their helmets, whatever other battery power they might be able to recharge their helmets with. You know, so it's gradually getting darker and darker. They were having to deal with despair. And this despair, as we now know, and as they have mentioned, led to violent arguments, disagreements, confrontations, and even fistfights among them. This is starting to come out at this point in time. They've been starting to talk about it just a little bit. At one point, the miners had divided into three mutually suspicious, somewhat hostile groups because of the fighting, the difficulties that they were facing. See, most of them, they were working in this mine. It was a big mine, 33 of them. They didn't really know each other all that well. They'd been there, maybe they'd seen each other. Some of the miners were new, they'd just been there. You know, this was their second week on the job. You know, so, wow, what a great job I got. Some of them had been there a long, long time. So They'd been come from all different types of walks of life, probably had a spectrum of political views, had all sorts of problems, these internal pressures dealing with despair, the suspicion, the fighting, the arguing. That at some point in time, they decided, they came to adopt a new attitude because they decided that if they were going to even have a remote chance of survival, they were going to have to pull together and work together. Otherwise, they were dead men because their situation seemed totally desperate. But during that time, those 17 days, while they were trying to figure out how they were going to deal with each other, how they were going to deal with a desperate situation, they started to come up with this new attitude. They decided that they needed to pull together to survive. They decided that they were not going to give up hope. They were going to pray. And these miners, I'm sure, prayed a lot. They had lots of time to pray. It was a very difficult situation because, you know, really from what I understand, they could only sleep for maybe 2 hours at a stretch. When they finally emerged, one of the comments, they were in relatively good health, but they were very much sleep deprived because it was that hard to sleep down there in the dark. For all the things going through your head and the heat and the whatever else, they decided that they were going to not give up hope. Of course, as we know, after 17 days, they discovered that they were still alive. The miners, when they heard, you know, when they finally were able to establish communications with them and they heard that they were aware that they were dying, that they were down there and that they were still alive, Of course, the situation was desperate because of the water and the food and the oxygen. But they were able, of course, as you know, to push through a little hole to be able to give them the essence of support. The miners at that point in time decided they needed to, they heard that they were going to be there because it's happened in early August. It heard that they were not going to get out by Christmas time probably, or barely out by Christmas time, which is a long time to be in a hole at 30 degrees, you know, with darkness and all these sorts of things. And all the conflict and all the pressure that they had, they decided that if they were going to survive this in any sort of situation, mentally and physically, that they were going to have to make some changes as a community of survivors. So they established new order, a new way that they decided that they were going to have to do things. They created routines and schedules for themselves that they were going to follow. They adopted new roles and responsibilities to ensure all their needs. Well, is to ensure to the degree they could help each other and the degree they could do so to fulfill what each other needed. Because you think about it, you're down there in a hole, in a mine, and you're having to survive, and there are 33 people. I can think of some immediate things you need to organize about. You probably can, too, if you think about it a little bit, how they were going to do things, how they're going to accomplish things. The lifeline to the outside did give them hope. It gave them a hope of survival, that lifeline. Not necessarily that they were going to survive. They knew better than that. Nobody has ever pulled out miners 700 meters below the surface of the ground, buried by 700,000 tons of rock. It was going to be a remarkable feat, technological feat, endurance feat for them to survive that period of time. They knew their chances were slim, but they did not give up hope. They had a lifeline to the outside. They had some communication. They had some meager sustenance, a little bit of, you know, water and food, sufficient. They had that was assured by this lifeline. I want you to think about this a little bit in an analogy to the church. So if you turn with me, let's go to Matthew chapter 16. Turn with me to the Gospel of Matthew chapter 16. The situation of the miners. Where are we with the Church of God? both here in Nanaimo and elsewhere. Chapter 16 and verse 13 says this. Now after coming into the parts of Caesarea Philippi, Jesus questioned his disciples, saying, "Whom do men declare me, the Son of Man, to be?" And they said, "Some say John the Baptist, others Elijah, and others Jeremiah, or one of the prophets." And he said to them, "But whom do you declare me to be?" Then Simon Peter answered and said, "You are the Christ, the Anointed One, the Son of the Living God." And Jesus answered and said to him, "Blessed are you, Simon Bar-Jonah, for flesh and blood did not reveal it to you, but my Father who is in heaven. And I say also to you that you are Peter," which is a Petros, which is a little stone. You're a pebble. You who understand this, my identity has been revealed to, you are but a little stone. You are Peter. Petros. But upon this rock, Petra, a massive crag, an outstanding body of rock, a remarkably large body of rock, upon this rock, Jesus said, "I will build my church, and the gates of the grave shall not prevail against it." One of the major religions, Christian religions, takes this to mean that Christ was saying that he was building his church on the pebble, on the human Peter. But that's not what, of course, Christ was saying. He's building his church on the Petra, not the Petros, on the massive amount of rock, which is Christ. And because he's building it on the one who was and who is and who will be, who had no beginning and who has no end, surely then Jesus could promise and say, "And the gates of the grave shall not prevail against it," because, of course, Jesus rose from the dead and he lives forever to assure the survival of his church. Let's go to 1 Corinthians. 1 Corinthians in the epistles of Paul. Let's go to 1 Corinthians chapter 1. 1 Corinthians chapter 1. 1 Corinthians chapter 1 and verse 9. God is faithful. For those Chilean miners who were down there in what seemed to them literal fulfillment of hell, whom they probably grew up thinking about a little bit or heard about from the church that they attended, they also knew, however, they might be in hell, they might be in the heart of the earth, or as it were, in their own graves, still breathing and living, but they realized that God is faithful, by whom you were called into the fellowship of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. God is faithful. We're called into the fellowship of his Son. This is, as I've talked and discussed before, we have the whole analogy of the Lord of the Rings. And they had the fellowship to try to defeat the power that was against them. And it was a fellowship that they were called into to strive together, to work together. They also had their conflicts and their difficulties and the things they had to overcome. But we're called by this faithful God into the fellowship of his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Now I exhort you, brethren, by the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, that you all speak the same thing, that there are no divisions among you, no fighting, no fist fights, no problems in the tunnels, as it were, rather that you be knit together in the same mind and in the same judgment. Of course, Paul did warn here in verse 11, "For my brethren, it has been declared to me concerning you by those of the house of Chloe that there are contentions among you." Jesus is our lifeline. He is our lifeline as the church. We are, as it were, in a sort of challenge at this point in time in this world. We're not buried by 700,000 tons of rock, but we certainly are encompassed about by a whole society that is working diligently against everything that the Bible teaches. But God is faithful, and we're called into companionship. We're called into participation with His Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, that we should be together, that we should be able to face this danger, that we should set up whatever we need to do and organize ourselves and work together to the best of the problem we can until we are delivered. Until we are delivered. Our goal in the Church of God is one of spiritual survival. We will help effect this end through our Christian service to the world and to each other. God expects us not just to sit on our hands and wait for rescue. The Chilean miners didn't just sit on their hands and give up hope, and every man for himself, and expect somehow someone to help them. They had a long time they were going to be in that position. If they were going to survive, if they were going to become out healthy and resilient rather than a basket case, they were going to have to work together. Let's go to Romans 12. Turn with me to Romans. I'll read this in the Amplified version. Romans 12 and verse 4. Romans chapter 12, the book of Romans. Chapter 12 and verse 4. Apostle Paul writes this. He says, "For as in one physical body we have many parts, organs or members," the Chileans had 33, and "all these parts do not have the same function or use, so we, numerous as we are one body in Christ, the Messiah. And individually, we are parts, one of another, mutually dependent on one another." The Chilean miners were mutually dependent on one another for their survival, for their mental health, to not fall into complete despair and despondency, and to give up, but to hang on. Verse 6, "having gifts," that is, faculties or talents or qualities "that differ according to the grace given us, let us use them." The Chileans had to look at themselves, the 33 of them, and said, "Okay, what are we, you know, who can do what well? Who can do what well? How do we organize so that we can do this?" They had a mixed, motley group of people. They had backgrounds and history before they had become miners. Some of them had been in the mine a long time. Some had been there a week. Some had been professional footballers and others, other things and laborers. How were they going to use their talents and skills to their mutual benefit or survival? They had to determine this. Who was good at what? Who should lead here? Who should lead there? How do they accomplish this? They had to consider this very carefully because their lives were at stake, and they had to be willing to stop fighting among themselves and to use their talents for the benefit of the group, the benefit of the fellowship, those 33. Our goal, truly, in the Church of God is one of escaping a dead-end entombment in our carnal nature, being limited by our physical body. We are to grow into true freedom, that stature which is in the fullness of Christ. Let's go to Ephesians, book of Ephesians, chapter 4. Ephesians 4. Ephesians 4 and verse 13. "Until we all come into the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God, unto a perfect man, unto the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. This is an exhortation that Apostle Paul is making to us that applies to the broader church of God in that context, the macro context of the church as a whole. It applies on a micro context on an individual congregation basis, such as here in Nanaimo. Until we all come into the unity of the faith and the knowledge of the Son of God, unto a perfect man, unto the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. That's our goal. That's our commission, really, in many ways. This is something we need to do. This is our, as it were, what we should be trying to aim for. This is where we're going, just like the miners could try to visualize themselves on the surface of the earth once more, not buried under 700,000 tons of rock and in darkness and heat, but to that glorious liberty of feeling the air upon your face and being able to see their loved ones again. God, in order for us to accomplish this and to do this, to come into this unity of the faith, to come into this knowledge of the Son of God, and to become the perfect person who is truly created and has been recreated, as it were, in ourselves, that full measure of Christ, God does not let us just, we're not doing this on our own work. He gives us a lifeline. He gives us a way of sustenance and of comfort, something that gives us hope so that we shall not and will not and can't and should not despair, something that we can use to share and to encourage others. Let's go to John in the Gospels, Gospel of John. You turn with me, John chapter 14. John chapter 14. John 14, verse 15. If you love me, Jesus said, keep my commandments, namely my commandments, and I will ask the Father, and he will give you another comforter, that it may be with you throughout the age. Even the Spirit of truth, which the world cannot receive because it perceives it not, nor knows it. See, the world, as we're coming up to Halloween here in a couple of weeks, doesn't understand and cannot perceive the Spirit of truth. Why should we worship the powers of darkness that entomb the human spirit? Why do we worship pagan deities, even trying to make light of it? They don't perceive that there's something wrong with it. They don't know the Spirit of truth, which the world cannot receive because it perceives it not, nor knows it. But you know it, because it dwells with you and shall be in you. I will not leave you orphans, Jesus said. He said this to his disciples. He says that to you and he says it to me. He's not leaving us orphans. He's not forsaking us. Those miners, those 33 miners, for 17 days, they couldn't help but wonder if they were forsaken. If you go out on a boat off the coast of Vancouver Island, and your boat shows up, you know, the keel is to the sky, and you know there's some flotsam and whatever floating around. They might look for you for a day or two. They'll send out the helicopters and maybe look for you for a day or two, or maybe even three or four. But then they call off the search, and you're on your own. They give up. And I mean, this isn't where necessarily people are buried under 700,000 tons of rock 700 meters down. They're just lost in some on the ocean. A vast place to look. So these miners were well aware. They were must have thought, you know, who's going to possibly, we're going to cost millions and millions of dollars. You know, they're only paying us this. It's not, you know, they could pay our families the, you know, 30,000 pesos or whatever it is and say that's the way it goes. But God is our lifeline. He is our hope. He gives us the spirit of comfort. He gives us the spirit of comfort, even the spirit of truth. I will not leave you orphans, he says in verse 18. I will come to you. See, Jesus will return. I will rescue you. Yet a little while, then the world shall see me no longer, but you shall see me because I live, you shall live also. And the gates of hell, or the gates of the grave, will not prevail against the church because Jesus lives. And he will come and he will rescue us. But while we have this lifeline, the Holy Spirit, the fact that we know that God is faithful and will not forsake us. He's better than the U.S. Marines, you know, who don't leave them behind, you know. He's better than that. We can count on him. He's 5 times, 10 times better than having your buddies in the Marine Corps, you know, who try to pull you out. Jesus will succeed. He is faithful. I will not leave you orphans. I will come to you. It's a promise that he gives us. So we have our lifeline. Are we aware of our external pressures, the external dangers that face us in this Christian walk? Are you really aware of them? Let's go to 1 Peter and the general epistles. 1 Peter. And let's go to chapter 5 and verse 8. 1 Peter 5 and verse 8. Be sober. Be vigilant. Because the RCMP may stop you, and if you blow 0.05, you're in trouble, or higher. You're in deep trouble. It says, be sober, be vigilant, for your adversary, the devil, is prowling about as a roaring lion, seeking anyone he may devour. His prey, brethren, includes every one of us in this room and everyone who's listening on the internet. You are his natural prey. That's who he's looking for. This is an external danger. A very real external danger that is there and lurking at all times. Be aware of the external pressure and danger. It is there, brethren. Let's turn. We need to be aware of something else, though. It's not just the external pressures, just like the Chilean miners had all that rock pressing upon them. Their shift, they could lose, you know, the rest of the shafts that they were in could collapse. They were aware of the external danger, but also they were aware of the internal dangers and pressures that they faced as well. Let's go to Ephesians 4, Epistle of Paul to the Ephesians, Ephesians chapter 4. Ephesians 4 and verse 22, Ephesians 4 verse 22. That concerning your former conduct, you put off the old man. Now, to be gender neutral here, if you're a woman, to put off the old woman, I'm sorry. But to put off the old man, to put off the old woman, which is corrupt according to deceitful lusts, and be renewed in the spirit of your mind, that you may put on the new man, which according to God is created in righteousness and holiness of the truth. Therefore, let each one put away lies and speak the truth with his neighbor, because we are members one of another. This is what the Chilean members, the miners, had to do. They had to put off the old man, as it were. The lives that they had, the persons even, the personnel, some of the personality that they were before, they had to learn to collaborate with each other for their own mutual survival. They had to put aside, you know, whether some of them had supported the rightists in the previous coup, or they were rabid leftists, or whatever that might have been, and you can believe there were probably a variety of opinions of how they looked at this and personality types. They had to put these things aside. They had to take a look at the eternal pressures, and they had to put off that corrupt old human being with all the problems and the difficulties and the wrong attitudes and whatever else. They had to recognize that that was an internal enemy that they had to be aware of and deal with. Then they had to have an attitude of never giving up. They had realized that they couldn't allow each other to sink into despondency and despair, because it would spread like a cancer throughout all of them. Because if they had taken up a tune of despondency and despair among themselves, the human spirit is remarkable, but if it's broken, susceptible to any sort of problems. They had to watch their spirits, that they did not give up hope, but rather kept hope. Let's go to Philippians 4 and verse 13. Philippians 4 and verse 13. It says what? It says, I can do all things through Christ who empowers me. I can do all things through Christ who empowers me. You know, even when they came, got through that communication, that little communication shaft, that little tube, that they can feed them a bit of air, and they could feed them a certain amount of water, and they could feed them, pass down food, and they could do, you know, they could talk with them, some of these things. They realized, of course, what was being attempted was a remarkable technological feat, to try to rescue them. I mean, even though people know they were down there alive, doesn't mean they were coming out. And they had to recognize that. But they had to say to themselves that God is faithful, that I can do all things through Christ who empowers me. And I'm sure they did pray long, many days. They had lots of time to consider it, to develop and to have the right attitude, and to work as setting the right example for each other. As they said, they organized themselves. They set themselves new schedules and new tasks. They put people in charge of this and people in charge of that, and they worked to try to meet their needs and to keep themselves so that they weren't going to fall in despair, that they had hope, and that they were caring for each other. We in the church also have our... We can do all things through Christ. There's nothing we can't do. I mean, this is what it says. I can do all things through Christ who empowers me. I've said this to myself many a time when I've gone in to face a difficult situation. I had to go into four people who had a lot more power or tremendously amount more money, and I needed them to do something. You and I both need to remember that we can do all things through Christ who empowers us. This is going to be especially important in the years to come. We have to maintain that lifeline to the Father and to our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ through His Spirit. We must keep on setting personal examples of righteousness to know and to love each other. You know, I've seen, brethren, what you do for others at times. I don't see, of course, everything. I just see some things. God appreciates your service. He appreciates what you're doing in serving the church. The prayers that you offer for others, the encouragement you might give at different times, exhortation, perhaps teaching too. Whatever uplifting conversation, whether it's on Facebook or the phone calls, helping others to focus on God's instructions and what He has to say to us. He'll provide a listening ear. I know some of you are pretty good at listening. I see providing a listening ear. Some of you are good at that, comforting others. Some of you show hospitality. You care for others, even in the physical things, such as the minors needed, whether it's food or water, you know, clothing, sheltering saints. We have all the preparation and cleanup for services. All the things that we are necessary to be done, they have been done. You are to be commended for that, brethren. And those that who have provided music to praise God. Because we praise God not just individually and alone, but we praise God communally as a congregation. And those who've labored and served in this deserve their praise and thanks. And those who've done their outreach in the community and volunteering, whatever it might be, all these things are good, and you deserve your praise, brethren, for doing this. The Christian life is all about growth and change. We need to think soberly about ourselves. Reflect on how God has led us, your walk with Him, and appreciate what you've done well with God's help. Because it's important to realize what you have done well. The 33 miners realized they came out, and they came out as national heroes. They never expected. They just said, we're ordinary people. But that's what makes it such a powerful example, is that they were just ordinary people. Because after all, when it comes down to it, there are just ordinary people. That's all we are. But it's the ordinary people who do remarkable things that shows the power of good. We need a sense of gratitude for what God has been able to do with us and what others have done. We express that gratitude. Consider how we have yet to grow to be of greater service to God. That is something that we need to think about. Because, of course, we never reach just a plateau. We have to reach the goal. In 2007, I had a bit of a mission statement for our congregation here that I have in my computer that I know I've spoke about before. It's, you know, over the last 5 years, I guess it's, you know, it's one of the many sermons I've talked about at different times. It set forth our objectives of how we would work together and how we might achieve them. It's not new in that we're not formulating some sort of something that was different, but we were using some guiding principles that are common to the Church of God and that we've been living with and we've known for many, many years. And since that time, after 3 years of being here and working together as part of CGI, it's a good time to reflect on how we've grown and where we're going. The mission statement that I had down here was to prepare a people through service to God and man so that our Lord will say, well done, my good and faithful servant. To use our diverse talents. So what were our objectives as the church, as a congregation here in Nanaimo? It was one, what was it? We remember to use our talents, our diverse talents, our differing talents, in the service to the body of Christ. Let's go to Romans 12 and verse 5. Romans 12 and verse 5. Romans 12 and verse 5. Using our diverse talents in the service to the body of Christ. We being many are one body in Christ and individually members of one another. Having then gifts differing according to the grace that is given us, let us use them. Not sit on them. Not give up in despair and wait until we're rescued and meanwhile we just sit and cuddle up in a fetal position. No, let us use them. If prophecy, let us prophesy in proportion to our faith. If ministry, let us use it in our ministering. He who teaches in teaching, he who exhorts in exhortation, he who gives with liberality, he who leads with diligence, he who shows mercy with cheerfulness, be kindly affectionate to one another with brotherly love and honor, giving preference to one another, not lagging in diligence, fervent in spirit, serving the Lord, rejoicing in hope, patient in tribulation, continuing steadfastly in prayer, distributing to the needs of the saints, given to hospitality. So it was an objective. The first one was to use our diverse talents as the body of Christ. And the body has many members We should be focusing on using these things. We will achieve this objective by empowering everyone to serve the congregation in areas which are commensurate with the talents and gifts. Have we achieved that? Do we have more room to grow? Is there more we can do with our individual talents? Can we grow our talents? Can we make things do more? Can we offer more as a congregation to our community out large? What can we do? Number two, to support and encourage the brethren in their walk with God. Let's go to Galatians 6. It's Galatians chapter 6, and take a look at verse 2. Galatians 6, verse 2 and verse 10. I'll just read those. Galatians 6, verses 2, and then I'll pop over to verse 10. Bear one another's burdens, and so fulfill the law of Christ. Therefore, this is the latter part of that verse, as we have opportunity, let us do good to all. It's to all people in Nanaimo or wherever else we are, especially to those who are of the household of faith. And we achieve that objective by building friendships in the congregation through regular fellowship at services and through the week. Most of the minors were somewhat, you know, they maybe had seen each other's faces, but they were strangers to each other, really. And when they came under the external threats and then they realized they were facing their internal threats too, it took them a while to get a grip on where they were going so that they would not tear each other apart but would work together for their mutual survival. We must bear each other's burdens. We must do good to all, especially those of the household of faith. That was to support and to encourage the brethren in the work of God. That was objective two. Objective three, to teach our young people the joy of living God's way of life. And I can think of course, here is Malachi chapter 4 and verse 4. Malachi 4 and verse 4, where it states, remember the law of Moses, my servant, with the statutes and judgments. Behold, I will send you Elijah the prophet before the great day of the Lord, and he will turn the hearts of the fathers to the children and the children to the fathers, lest I come and strike the earth with a curse. We achieve this objective through things like weekly Sabbath school. We can achieve it through things like interactive Bible studies, teen presentations. We can do it through local youth campouts and activities. We can support CGI's youth programs as our resources permit. This is an area that can be of significance to our congregation, especially since, really, we have to be concerned about passing on the legacy of the Church of God to a new generation. How well are we doing with this? Can we do better? Number four, to provide a positive, nurturing environment for and holy day worship. Objective four, teaching and fellowship for those who desire to learn to serve God in spirit and in truth, which is, of course, the whole reason why we have the fellowship. The fellowship is for us to have the opportunity to be able to participate in each other's lives and be able to give a word of encouragement. How are we growing? It's not just talking about the weather, but we're talking about providing a nurturing environment in the fellowship, so that we can support each other, so that we don't despair, so that we can be the best that we can be, so that we can grow, so that we can greet people who come in from the outside among us and show them love and concern, be able to help them, open doors to real life to them, to show ourselves friendly, to care for each other, so that no one feels neglected, that you don't take an interest in them, that you ignore them. How well do we do this? Hebrews 10 and verse 24 says this, let us consider one another in order to stir up love and good works, not forsaking the assembling of ourselves together as the manner of some, but exhorting one another, and so much the more as you see the day approaching. And the day is definitely approaching. The day is definitely approaching. He said we'll achieve this objective with weekly services, sermons, sermonettes, occasionally videos, song service, Sabbath school for the youth, time for fellowship. We can do all those things. We have been doing many of those things. There's more that could be done. Objective number 5, to be a light to the community through our example of obedience and service to God. Let's go to Matthew 5 and verse 14, where this objective is mentioned in the scriptures. Matthew 5 and verse 14, verse 16, Jesus said this. He said, and this is to us, he's speaking, of course. You are the light of the world. A city that is set on a hill cannot be hidden. No, it can't be. If you're ever out in an area that's hilly and you have a city on a hill or a town on a hill, especially this day of electric lights, you can see it from a long ways away. It's always a remarkable thing to be in a plane and be flying even 30,000 feet up in the air, and it's nighttime, and you can look out your window, and you can see the light, the cities. You go across a dark landscape. You are the light of the world, Jesus is saying to us. A city that is set on the hill cannot be hid, nor do you put it under a basket, but on a lampstand, and it gives light to all who are in the house. So we can't hide who we are. We can't hide our congregation. This isn't a secret society, a secret organization. The door is open. Can we even make it more so that we're not hidden, that people know we're here? What can we do to let more know that we're here? Let your light so shine before men so that they may see your good works and glorify your Father in heaven. And we do this. We can do this through our personal contact with friends and neighbors and community. We can do this through the internet. We can do this many ways so that people can see our light better and more effectively. There are areas we can grow in. There are areas we can improve upon in this. Objective 6, to care for those experiencing physical and spiritual needs in our community. Let's go to Matthew 25. Matthew 25 and verse 35. Matthew 25 and verse 35. Matthew 25 and verse 35. For I was hungry and you gave me food. I was thirsty and you gave me drink. Of course, that's one of the remarkable things about the Chile. You know, the Chileans really did pull together. They actually cared for those people down stuck 700 meters below the surface of the earth. It was amazing they were able to provide them with what they needed. I was a stranger and you took me in. I was naked and you clothed me. I was sick and you visited me. I was in prison and you came to me. Inasmuch as this, you did this to one of the least of my brethren, you did it unto me. We will fulfill this objective by developing outreach programs in our areas. I know, brethren, that we have individuals who do some of these things at different times. It's good if we could actually think about perhaps it's something to consider to help fulfill this so that we could do more as a group. Objective 7, to preach the gospel of the kingdom of God and teach God's commandments to our generation. Preaching the gospel of the kingdom of God and to teach God's commandments to a new generation, it's not voluntary. It's not, I should say, it's not something that we can pass on. It's something we should do. What does Jesus say? Matthew 28, verse 18, all authority has been given unto me in heaven and earth, Jesus said. So I have all this authority. I am where the buck stops. Go, therefore, he's saying, and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all things I have commanded you, and lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the age. We will achieve this objective, we said here back 3 years ago, with an Nanaimo Church website, local outreach in support of CGI's media programs. Well, we've been able to get these things going. This is something we have been able to start on. We probably have much more that we can do. So we need to ask ourselves, how am I doing? How am I doing so far? How are we doing as a congregation? Where are we going? What are we going to try to achieve over the next 3 years, the next 5 years, the next 10 years, if we have it? If we have it. Where are we going? John Kosh sent me an email this week, and he asked me to actually read it. And he's coming for a visit to Nanaimo on October 30th. And hopefully Eric will find the place where we need to go. Otherwise, I suppose we'll be meeting someplace else. If we can't find a larger place, we'll meet in a smaller place, I suppose. But anyways, he's going to be, he and Rick Dubler are coming. They're going to do split sermons. And their theme is going to be the Church of God. Now, John is planning on leading a discussion after services. And he says, and he says, I expect full participation by all, and that's all caps, all, A-L-L, emphasis, all baptized members who consider themselves part of the CGI. And these are the questions he's expecting you to answer. So you might take note, because you will be asked to answer these. Okay, this is something you're asked to participate. It's not something you can pass on to me or just pass on to Eric. This is something for you. This is your homework to think about. You've got 2 weeks to prepare. He's going to ask you these questions. And he's going to expect you to participate and answer. What kind of church are you? Okay, that's one of the questions. What kind of church do you want to be? What is God's vision for the church? Solving future matters so the church wins. I'll repeat those. What kind of church are you? What kind of church do you want to be? What is God's vision for the church? Solving future matters so the church wins. This discussion is desired to make sure that Nanaimo Church has a consistent viewpoint among the church with respect to culture, direction, and doctrines. The end result should be a written record of what you agree upon that all can reconsider along the way and seek to make work for everyone. Like the Chilean miners. Something you have to come together to work together to assure the survival of the congregation. In that each individual ceases to think, what do I want independently, but rather seeks to work interdependently to achieve the goals of the church in love. So when John comes in a couple weeks, he's going to ask us these questions. We'll get together, and it's not something you can pass on if you're the Church of God member, baptized member. He's going to ask you to come, to say what you need to say. And so, just like we had, the world shares miners' victory. The world shares miners' victory. This is what the editorial had to say. God is looking forward to sharing our victory. He's looking for the time that's coming in the future when he will send his son, Jesus Christ, and he will rescue us out of this entombment that we have, both in this mortal flesh at this time and in this world that is blinded by the adversary who seeks to devour us. We shall achieve the victory. At least the Church of God as a whole will achieve that victory. Where are we going? We want to also be there for that time when Christ returns and delivers his church and his people from a living death in an age that is filled with spiritual darkness. Brethren, we have a few weeks to prepare. We look forward to Rick Dubler and John Kosh coming, and so that we can be profitable servants for the next bit as we focus and refocus and think about how we can grow, how we can be interdependent, how we can do more and achieve more. We have done well, we're here, but we can do more. And we have much to accomplish because the needs are great in this society, in this world. And we can't just rest on our laurels. So, thank you.